A worrying warning from a senior US general this week who claims the British Army isn't fit for purpose and may not be able to protect the UK from Russian aggression. Is he right? Well, Ava and Richard are still with me. I'm delighted to be joined by the former head of the British Army, Lord Dannatt. Lord Dannatt, great to see you. Happy 2023. It's our first encounter of the new year. Pretty sobering reading this, I have to say, as someone who's had family in the military in recent years myself, to see the British Army described in that way was a bit disconcerting. What were your thoughts?
Well, the anonymous American general isn't actually far wider than mark, as Ben Wallace and James Heappey, the Minister of State for the Armed Forces, have both acknowledged. I mean, the fact of the matter is that the Army has received the lowest priority in terms of Ministry of Defence spending for the last 10 to 15 years. Huge history of underinvestment. So therefore, it's not surprising that our capability is not what we would wish it to be. It's a matter of government choice. It's a matter of Ministry of Defence choice. And then eventually, when push comes to shove, you have to deal with the consequences. But, you know, if as long as the position is now being realised, there is a chance for Ben Wallace to argue the case for greater resources for defence to try and up the investment as quickly as possible.
What did you make of Boris Johnson saying that Vladimir Putin had basically threatened him with a missile?
Interesting, Piers. I've heard Boris say quite a lot of things over the years. Whether he misheard that on the telephone call with Vladimir Putin, I don't know. I mean, the fact of the matter is that there is an accepted international code of conduct between international leaders that they don't take each other out. So I think we take that half seriously and half with a pinch of salt. It was a good Boris line. It caught a good headline. And I think let's just move on.
Are you suggesting that our recently dearly beloved departed Prime Minister can't be entirely relied upon when it comes to veracity of his rhetoric?
Oh, I wouldn't suggest that, Piers. But what I would say is that it was quite colourful. It was very Boris. And I'm sure it was rooted in a grain of truth, but it may have been slightly over-exemplified to catch the headlines, which it duly did.
We're now at a crucial stage in this war in Ukraine, coming up to the first anniversary. Isabel Oakeshott, our international editor at Talk TV, she interviewed Ben Wallace, Defence Secretary. And we've got this particular clip to play to you, if you just want to listen to this.
How seriously do you take the threat that he might use tactical nuclear weapons?
Well, it is always a serious threat simply because it is in Russian doctrine.
Yeah.
They have an acceptable view that you can have such a thing as a strategic nuclear weapon and a tactical nuclear weapon.
Yes.
And their idea of a tactical nuclear weapon can be 10 times the size of Hiroshima.
I mean, that's, a sobering statement for the Defence Secretary to make. What is the likelihood or possibility that a cornered Vladimir Putin, if he feels like he is losing this war with all the dishonour that would then be heaped on him back home, that he might be tempted to utilise what is still the biggest nuclear force in the world?
Well, Piers, let's just put Ben Wallace's comment into context. If a tactical nuclear weapon was 10 times the ferocity of Hiroshima and unleashed on Ukraine, Ukraine would then join Pluto and Mars somewhere in the stratosphere. I mean, that's just not going to happen. If we're talking about genuine tactical nuclear weapons, we're talking about a nuclear weapon which could cause destruction and damage over, say, a 3 to 5 kilometre area. Now, how could that be employed? Let's just go back to last autumn when the Ukrainians mounted a very successful counter-offensive around Kharkiv, and they broke through the Russian lines. That is the moment that if you're desperate, you then consider using a tactical nuclear weapon. But just think about this one for a moment. Those four provinces into which the Ukrainians are now counter-attacking, those four provinces were declared by Putin to be forever Russia. So here's the question. Why would Putin want to irradiate for the next 50 years some territory that he's declared forever Russia? It just doesn't stack up.